I'm Laura Kurgan, and I'm the director of the Center for Spatial Research here at, in the Architecture School. So we are on the sixth floor of the architecture building, but our architects kind of spread out across all kinds of buildings in the across Columbia. And in this room, we have an incredibly interdisciplinary group. So we have a lot of people from anthropology, from the Institute for Comparative Literature and Society. We have some economics majors. We have urban designers, architects, curatorial studies. And the reason we have such a diverse group is because Lydia Liu, co-teacher, and I, each have grants from the Mellon Foundation. Mine is called Architecture, Urbanism, and the Humanities. And the mandate of both the center and the grant is to teach methods of critical mapping, digital mapping, and data visualization across the humanities, including architecture. And part of the research mission of this four-year grant, or the research topic that we proposed, is conflict urbanism. So every year in the spring, we run a conflict urbanism seminar. Last year it was conflict urbanism Aleppo, and I collaborated with Sabino and Shalom in art history. And if you go to the website and you look at the work that's got done there, you'll be actually quite amazed. It was an incredibly great group of students, and then over the summer, kind of workshop some of the work that occurred in the seminar and made it better and developed it, and then we took a lot of new directions over the summer as well, which will happen this summer too. And so this spring, if the topic is conflict, urbanism, language, justice, right? So we thought probably from Aleppo that conflict means urbanism and war. It actually really doesn't. So we're also looking at everyday conflicts that occur in cities. As we know, 65% of the world is now urbanized, and there's all kinds of injustices and inequities that occur as cities become, as more people are migrating from rural areas to cities. And so when I, Sharon Marcus, who's not here today, but she's the co-PI on this Mellon grant, and in our sort of committee where we were discussing who we should be working with, Sharon suggested Lydia, because they had just put together this project on language justice, which she will explain. But the reason that I'm so excited about collaborating on this conflict urbanism language justice is because Lydia has really defined language more as an ecology rather than a series of signs and symbols, and that immediately locates it in an urban setting, because you think about how is language sustainable economically, culturally, socially, etc. And so I'll introduce Lydia. Okay. And then after Lydia, Michelle McSweeney is actually a postdoc in the Center for Spatial Research, and she comes from a linguistics background, but also has a digital humanities, focuses on digital humanities through the linguistics work. And so she has brought incredible expertise, and is also teaching a series of workshops directly catered to urbanism and language in New York City. So all our students this semester are going to be studying language in New York City. And you will see why very soon. We've invited Dan. That will be completely self-evident. Okay?
Hi everybody, it's good to see such a mixed crowd, people who are interested in so many aspects of language. As Laura said, the Institute for Comparative Literature and Society recently received a Mellon grant it's a two-year story seminar on the subject of global language justice. And so we take a radically different approach to the problem of language. as we recognize the rapid decline of endangered languages and also the correlations of the decline of the world's languages with the decline of biospecies. And there are scholars who are pursuing the studies of these subjects, and so by definition, the study of the ecology of language is interdisciplinary. But unlike Laura's project, which started 2 years ago, we are about to start. This is a new project that will kick off in the fall of this year. So you will hear from us in the fall. We'll have a major poetry event. We'll invite poets from all over the world to read their work in their own original languages. So literature is part of it. And we will have also a series of lectures like the one we're having today, this semester, and a series of workshops. And we will also have a postdoc fellow, and we include some graduate students, those of you who are interested in working on the subject. We would love to have you join us. And I'm very happy to be co-teaching this course with Laura and with Michelle Sweeney, both teaching the course and learning how to visualize data.
Yeah, he's actually taking the workshop.
I'm taking the workshop. So learning how to navigate through this very complicated cyber space. I won't take up too much of your time. I'm eager to hear what Dan Kaufman has to say about his current research on endangered languages. And so I will invite Michelle to come and introduce Professor Kaufman.
Thank you. So as has already been stated, a large part of the reason that this speaker series is existing is to understand how languages and cities come together. So it is a huge honor and a huge pleasure for me to be able to introduce Dan Kaufman today, partially because he's helped shape my early graduate career, but also because he has worked on preserving, documenting, and raising awareness of endangered languages in New York City over at least as long as I've known him. At least since 2008, probably earlier. And he's been the director of the Endangered Language Alliance, formerly the Urban Fieldstation for Linguistic Research. And in that role, he's contributed immensely to public awareness of the sheer variety of languages spoken in New York City, and why language matters to the health of our city. And he is now also an assistant professor at Queens College, where he's establishing the Language Documentation Lab to train students in documentation and research. So please join me in welcoming Professor Dan Kaufman.
Thank you to all of you for coming. Thanks to Michelle, Laura, Lydia for inviting me. It's my first time to give a talk in an architecture school. First of all, to be introduced by three people. Professions on. Let's see if this works. So, I have a lot I wanted to talk about. I wanted to introduce, since a few of you are linguists, I think, I wanted to introduce the notion of language endangerment and endangered languages, how they become endangered, why it's important, and then talk, of course, about New York City and all of the urban issues that are being explored in this larger series and this project. So I'll first kind of work backwards, maybe just introduce briefly what the organization does, the organization that Michelle mentioned, the Endangered Language Alliance, and then talk a little bit about language endangerment as a phenomenon, and then move to New York City. These are the questions I promised to talk about in the abstract. Don't hold me to it. I'd like to talk about where do New York City's endangered languages come from, what phenomena have driven them here, Do the languages have chances of survival in a diaspora setting like New York City? How widespread is the problem of language isolation? I doubt I'll have much time to talk about that. Can immigrant communities in New York City have a positive effect on language prestige and transmission back in the homeland? And what is the future of New York City's linguistic diversity? And I also want to talk about, of course, the mapping issues that are central to this project. So, moving backwards, as I said, so what does our organization do? We're very much interested in literacy and supporting people's mother tongues in New York City. So communities that have no official support, speakers of languages that are unwritten, regional languages that are not official languages. We're interested in supporting those people to help them continue their languages in New York City. We're very much interested in documenting those languages, and that's where most of our effort goes. Documenting those languages in audio and video, recording stories, narratives, poetry in some cases, in languages that have never been recorded well in some cases before. This is a collaborator of ours, Sonaida Cantu, who speaks Mepa, which is an indigenous Mexican language from Guerrero, Mexico. Indigenous radio is something we're also involved in, so we have programs on internet radio in Mayan language and in Garifunan as well. That's a small thing that happens, and also pedagogical materials as well. And performance. We try and support performance in indigenous languages. This is performance in Tontemboan, I mean, Minahasan language, a language that is not really spoken widely, even within the region it comes from in Indonesia. Yes, performance. Well, yes, this relates to the literary side of the project. So poetry is another thing that we're interested in and we're trying to promote, trying to get people who speak oral languages that have not been written down traditionally to write their languages and even to try and publish some of that work. This was a performance of, well, Irish, which is a language with a long written history. Nahuatl. So that's kind of in a nutshell what our organization does and what we're interested in doing. As I said, our main focus is really on documentation, recording and archiving endangered languages in New York City. To give you just a rough idea of what language endangerment looks like globally, there exists between 6,000 and 7,000 languages in the world today. 95% of the world's people speak around 5% of the world's languages. And it's estimated that between half or up to 90% of the world's languages will be gone by the end of the century. And I'll get into the reasons in a second. In addition, there's fewer and fewer languages being actually born, which is something that is not spoken of nearly as much, but you can imagine the kind of conditions that give rise to language diversity, rich ecological environments, islands, rainforests, things like that. Those areas are no longer what they used to be, obviously. And so not only are languages disappearing, there seems to be very little future for new languages, really. So what creates language diversity, as I said, biologically rich environments allow small groups to survive and evolve independently. A few square miles of rainforest can allow a population to survive relatively independently, and thus the evolution of their culture and their way of speaking can lead to a new language after hundreds or thousands of years. So biodiversity leads to linguistic diversity. On the other hand, large states require large-scale agriculture, and agriculture leads to biological leveling and dependency on the state economy. So what ends up happening is the leveling of linguistic diversity really does mirror that of biodiversity. Biologists estimate that the extinction of species is now occurring at a rate 1,000 times greater than that in the pre-industrial era, and something comparable is happening with languages as well. Right? And the connection is quite clear. As societies become agricultural and as they further become industrial, people are no longer able to survive the way they used to, the traditional livelihoods in villages, and they're forced into cities to make a living, to earn cash, to pay for things like schooling, and they're taken out of their language area, basically. Right? So that's a big factor in language loss. So UNESCO has come up with the following criteria, because now that people have started to care over the last 40, 50 years, these things have to be measured, and that's what the UN is good at. So UNESCO comes up with criteria which are more or less well accepted. The most important factor is not the size of a language or the size of language population, it's actually transmission, right? So you can have a language population of 200 or 3,000 or even half a million speakers, but if the language isn't being transmitted to children, then things can change very rapidly, right, in the course of one or two generations. So intergenerational transmission is the number one factor, right? These are ranked in accordance with importance. And then the absolute number of speakers. And then the proportion of speakers within the total population, right? Because that makes a difference as to how much power that group will have. Shifts in domains of language use, so that's, for instance, if education comes into a rural place and now only the official language is allowed in the schools, that's a large shift in domain. People can no longer use their language for most of the day. Response to new domains in media, so texting, for instance, has spread throughout the world over the last 10, 15 years. Whether people choose their local language or their national language or a global language in texting is hard to guess, but it has a very powerful effect on the future of the language. The availability of materials for language education, governmental and institutional language attitudes, community members' attitudes towards their own language. Some communities find language to be an inextricable part of their identity. In some rare cases, a community may just look at a language as a historical relic. That is obviously affects the future of the language and the amount and quality of documentation. Right? Is a language recorded? Is it described? If there's very few speakers, can the community go back to that language? Can they hear that language? So things can change very rapidly, as I said. Right? So to give one concrete example, when we started recording different communities here in New York City, one of the groups we were working with was one individual working with was a speaker of Neo-Aramaic from Iraq. Now, 7 years ago or so, Neo-Aramaic was already considered by UNESCO a severely endangered language, or definitely, and they have all these rankings, definitely endangered, right? That's one step away from severely. But within the last 7 years, you have, right, and you have something today like 240,000 speakers, which is a very large number, right, of Neo-Aramaic. But over the last 7 years, Mosul, which was their biggest population center, was taken by ISIS, and everything completely changed, right? So now the entire population, almost without exception, is out of their area, their homeland in the area around Mosul, and they're in Kurdistan and Turkey and other areas. So within just in the course of 5 years, the language has become apparently untenable if things continue the way they are. If we look at language death, just to give you kind of two edges of the spectrum, right, which I think are, it is a spectrum, and I think it's important to think about the two extremes. So on one extreme, you find colonialism and genocide. And so this is the last speaker of Skolo Hakomelam Salish, the indigenous language of British Columbia and Canada. And the way this language became endangered was through the residential boarding school and all of the policies that were almost identical in Canada and the United States. This happens to be just a recent example. She happens to be the last speaker of a language that was mentioned recently in the news, but one can find similar stories almost every month. So they summarize her story as this. When Elizabeth Phillips was a child, she was put into St. Mary's Indian Residential School in Mission. She was forbidden to speak the language that both of her parents spoke to her as a baby. Phillips was a loner at the school, and supervising nuns became concerned that she wasn't associating with other children enough. While other children played, she would stand alone at the outside gate, staring out at the Fraser River and thinking in her language. And I guess that's what saved me, she says now, sitting outside her home in the Fraser Valley. And this turns out to be actually a very common story. It's really now the individuals that linguists and community members flock to, because they're the last speakers, those are the people who really escaped the residential schools. The residential schools were designed to erase the culture and the language of indigenous Americans, both in Canada and the United States. They went by different names, but the main idea was to turn them into European Americans. This is just to illustrate what those schools were all about. The Carlisle Indian School was one of the most famous ones. It was founded in 1879 by Colonel Pratt, who's famous for saying, "Kill the Indian and save the man." And this is a kind of before and after picture of Tom Torlino, who was a Navajo. And this was the before picture. He entered the school in something like 1879. And this is supposed to show him as what was perceived as a wild savage with long hair and dark skin. And then after a few years in the Carlisle Indian School, not only does he don a suit and have short hair, he even becomes whiter somehow. That's how amazing that school was. And that was one of the central schools, and they forced children from many tribes throughout the United States to enter there. And as I said, the goal was really to erase the language. That was a big goal, right? Not only the culture, but especially the language. There's this, on the other side of the spectrum, there's this idea that languages can kind of commit suicide. Right? So just to sum that up, Denison, from a quote by Denison, says, "A speech community sometimes decides, for reasons of functional economy, to suppress a part of itself. There comes a point when multilingual parents no longer consider it necessary or worthwhile for the future of their children to communicate with them in a low-prestige language variety, and when children are no longer motivated to acquire active competence in language which is lacking in positive connotations, such as youth, modernity, technical skills, material success, education. The language at the lower end of the prestige scale retreat from ever-increasing areas of their earlier functional domains, displaced by higher prestige languages until there's nothing left for them to be appropriately used about. In this sense, they may be said to commit suicide." So there's several linguists who believe in this idea of language suicide, and I think if you ask the average person, of course the average person hasn't really thought about language endangerment, I guess, but in as much as anybody has, they would probably say something like this. Once in a while they do interview people on the street about these topics, and they come up with something like this, that, oh yeah, languages become useless and people decide to stop passing it down to their children. It's very much a question, though, when you really look at individual stories and you dig a little deeper, whether language suicide is ever really happens, right? Or if it's really a case of coercion, even if it's not official coercion in the style of the Carlisle Indian School, lower level coercion that forces communities to give up their language. So more on the side of language suicide, you can find a community like this, which is a small fishing village in Scotland, right? And they were, this is the Cromarty dialect of English. It's an English dialect, which is almost, I would say, a different language. And these people were not the victims of genocide or colonialism, and yet they spoke a language that died out in 2012. This was the last speaker of this, of the Cromarty dialect. And the Cromarty dialect was just as interesting as anything. It had many influences, not only from Celtic languages, but also from Frisian and Dutch. Many terms about fishing and the natural environment that weren't found in Scots English. Well, I give you a little. Let's see if this works.
So, before the school, and then I get the time of the school, and then I can do as long as you know. I said, "Oh well, about what I'm doing here." So, like, I can do the all doing the something looking very funny. All the things you all are actually doing in the lines.
This is a dialect of English, believe it or not, but it's essentially a separate language, right? And even though the relationship to the community may be quite different than, say, the relationship to Hungarian Salish, and their community, it's still representative of a way of life and an identity. Right. And for linguists, it's also quite interesting, right? If you look at this, there's actually, just in this one little sentence of Cromarty English, there's several linguistic features that are actually quite interesting from the perspective of studying English, right? So this is another, on the other end of the spectrum. And if you look deeper, you probably would find that there was coercion and teasing and things that were kind of below the surface that led to the death of Cromarty. Okay. So what do we lose when we lose a language? I think the area that's been discussed most in the literature is things like botanical knowledge, environmental knowledge that's encapsulated in the lexicon of the language and the words of the language. You also have the entire oral tradition of the language, the songs, the poetry, the history, the things that are not written down, and the things which typically disappear when their linguistic vehicle disappears. And you also have linguistic knowledge, of course, right, which is of most interest to linguists. Right? And that includes sound patterns and grammatical patterns. Right? That's what we linguists care about. And then you have something which is more intangible, which is identity, the identity factor. Right? To give just an idea of what that is, this was a quote from a language activist, a Manchu language activist in North China, who realized that later in life that they were Manchu and said, at some point you realize that the first language you're speaking isn't your mother tongue. You feel like an orphan. You want to find your mother. So this is a more subtle, maybe purely psychological, internal connection to language, but it's just as important as anything else. And I think that this is the factor that's most often glossed over when we talk about endangered languages. Just to give an idea of what linguists are interested in, the geekery side maybe, this is two words of Kabardian, which is a Circassian language, indigenous language of the Kafkaz area in the Caucasus. And these are two words, right? And within these two words, this is what you call a glossed sentence, an interlinearized glossed sentence. And here you have the transcription of the word, and this represents the meaning of each part of the word, okay? And this is the meaning. So in English, you have a full sentence, I showed you to him, or we're going for a long walk. But in Kabardian, this is expressed in a single word. If you look at the second word in particular, you'll see just how rich the grammar is. Within this single word, you have all of these morphemes that have a slight, they invoke something different about the movement. So it's movement along a groove, it's somehow distributed movement, there's direction, there's an outwards movement, there's a turning movement. And all of these things are just affixes within the word. So the kind of richness that leads to this very complex word structure, I think, can be compared to a forest or some intense area of intense biological diversity, something that takes millennia to develop, right? This is not something that you would find in a language that could be developed overnight, right? In order to get this, you really have to have intergenerational transmission uninterrupted for hundreds, if not thousands of years, right? So this is kind of the loss that we're looking at linguistically when these languages disappear. Okay, so that's my brief introduction to language endangerment. I wanted to talk specifically about New York City, since, of course, that's what everybody loves for some reason. love, hate. So the two most interesting communities, I think, from a perspective of endangered languages are the Mexican community and the larger Himalayan community. In terms of linguistic density and linguistic diversity, it's really these two places in the world that give New York City the most languages, right? These are two of the most linguistically diverse and dense places in the world. So let's start with Mexico. Just to compare to some neighboring countries what that diversity actually looks like, Panama has 14 languages, several of them are in trouble or dying. Nicaragua has 11 languages, Honduras has 10 languages, El Salvador 4, Belize 14. Mexico has 282 indigenous languages, almost all of them are indigenous. 32 of those are deemed by the ethnologue, the largest catalog of linguistic information, as dying, and 87 are in trouble. Those are probably conservative figures. I would say that more are more than that are endangered. But it gives you the rough idea of how much diversity there is in this one country, right? Not only is there a tremendous number of languages, but there's also a tremendous genetic diversity. So the unlike most of Europe, which are most of the European languages belong to Indo-European, in this one country, Mexico, you find all of these language families. So these families are completely unrelated to each other, or at least we haven't found a way to relate them yet. So Udo-Aztecan, Yuman Pochimi, Kotonakan, Otomangen, etc. All of these are completely independent language families that have nothing to do with each other. So there's really an unprecedented level of linguistic diversity in this one country. Where is that diversity in Mexico? This is a map, a language map of Mexico, and you can see the different colors are all different languages, and you can see that as of today, the vast majority of linguistic diversity is in the south, right, in that little corner in the south, right? And those states are the state of Oaxaca and Guerrero, mostly. And that turns out to be exactly the states that have the most immigration to New York. Okay. To give a quick overview of what language policy was like in Mexico, you have basically 300 years of suppression and assimilation, as we had in the United States and Canada and elsewhere. And then finally, 1936, linguistic diversity is recognized. But it's only really in 2000, beginning in the 80s, but only really in 2000 that you have stronger national institutions that are tasked with defending these languages and conserving them. Right. So by that time, for many languages, it was already too late. The attitudes towards the languages were similar in Latin America as they were in the United States. So the first quote here is actually referring to Native Americans. Atkins, who was also involved in the residential school system, said, "In the difference of language today lies two-thirds of our trouble. Schools should be established, which children should be required to attend. Their barbarous dialects should be blotted out and the English language substituted." Right? This was the colonial English approach. And then 100 years later, the president of Guatemala says something similar, but this was just representative, really. This was nothing special about him. "We must do away with the word Indian or indigenous. Our mission requires the integration of all Guatemalans." Right? But that was just typical, still is typical of the attitudes towards assimilation, that it should be a subtractive process. Right? You should be removing indigenous identity. And then, surprisingly, to bring it back to New York, Herman Badillo, who was at the time the Board of Trustees chair for CUNY, the City University of New York, said, "The problem is that in Mexico and Central America, there's never been a tradition of education. They're pure Indians, Incas and Mayans, who are about, you know, 5 feet tall with straight hair. And when they speak about La Raza, they're not talking about the Spanish language, they're talking about the original Indian language. And therefore, it's a far more complicated problem than the problem we're used to dealing with." So, 100 years difference between the first quote and this quote, and many, many changes between them, of course, but the attitudes still basically remain the same, that these people need to be assimilated and their indigenous cultures need to be removed because they're an obstacle to education. I don't mean to pick on Lydia, I feel like. All right. So the indigenous population, nonetheless, is growing, right? Even though it's a beleaguered population, it's growing, and now, as of the 2000 census, there were 407,000 people nationwide who identified as Latinos of indigenous origin. In 2010, it was a 68% increase to 685,000. So to what extent that is real, to what extent that reflects immigration or just a change in self-identification, we will never know. But that gives you some idea of either a change in consciousness or also increased immigration from the indigenous areas of Mexico. So again, back to the details of New York, you have another interesting phenomenon here, which is that in Mexico itself, only 6% of Mexicans speak an indigenous language, according to their Bureau of Statistics. But based on a survey that was done in the consulate here, they found something like 17%, over 17% of the people who came to for consular services spoke an indigenous language. So that's almost three times the rate. And it's probably actually much more than that, because the people who seek services in the consulate are already those more established people. So there's three more, so the proportions, right, are very different here in New York. You have much more indigenous languages of Mexico spoken in New York, proportion-wise, than in Mexico. So the estimate would be something like over 86,000 speakers of indigenous Mexican languages. I wanted to play this, maybe I won't play it in totality, but this leads me to my next point, if it's audible. article? So, because actual information is extremely scarce on indigenous communities in New York City, Mexican communities, what we have to do is really, through interviews and more qualitative methods, find out what people are speaking, are there differences in the community here and back home, and all of the kind of sociolinguistic information we're interested in. And there's something interesting came up in this interview we did, which was the person on the far right, who's a speaker of Mixteco, said that here in New York, he said that as a matter of course, he speaks Mixteco, his language, at home and with his daughter and with his wife and with all of his friends and at work. But then when he talked about working in Acapulco, which is just not far at all from where his village is, he said, oh no, we would never speak Mixteco there. Because there, people would laugh at you, people would say, what is this crazy Indian talking? That's what he said, more or less, right? So that's an interesting phenomenon, right? So there's, because the languages are more removed, right, socially and culturally in New York City, there's actually occasionally more of an opportunity to use them. There's less of a stigma to use them in New York than there is back home in some cases. So a language like this, which would be highly stigmatized in Acapulco, here in New York, he does actually have the freedom to use it without fearing ridicule. Right? So that's one of the things we're interested in. His language turns out to be quite important in New York City. So some of the Mexican languages in New York that we've worked with are Mixteco, Triqui, Amusco, Tlapaneco, Mazatec, Zapoteco, Cuicateco, Tumichinantec, Nahuatl, Totonac, and Tepewa. But the majority of languages here are Mixtecan. And because, as I'll discuss in a second, their area was really devastated by several environmental factors. So La Mixteca has been, their area in Mexico has been declared an ecological disaster zone by the World Bank. You have something like 1 million acres ruined by soil erosion, and as a result, one of the lowest corn productivity rates in Mexico. And following that, NAFTA came and radically reduced the price of corn and bankrupted indigenous farmers. Right? As a result, you have massive out-migration of this area from La Mixteca in Mexico. Right? It ends up being one of the poorest zones in all of Latin America. There's malnutrition and empty villages as a result. Right? You have areas that have lost over 80% of their population. Right, so most of the indigenous immigrants from Guerrero and Oaxaca, New York, come from this background of extreme poverty. The situation is summed up actually pretty well by a photographer who did an interesting photography project in the area, really focusing on these emptied out villages where people have fled to New York and Los Angeles and other places. And he kind of put in perspective that chances are high that the food you've eaten recently was picked by a Mixtec immigrant. He's probably undocumented, and he probably earned far less than minimum wage for that work. His community back home is most likely in an advanced stage of depopulation, and if the current trajectory continues, his culture and language, among the oldest in all of the Americas, will likely disappear in the next generation or two. So that kind of sums it up. People fled their villages in order to do mostly agricultural labor in California and in New York, working in kitchens and other menial labor. There was all of a sudden a great concern about this Mexican educational statistics in New York City after an article by Semple in 2011, where he noted that there was a very high dropout rate in the Mexican community, much higher than any other immigrant community. So there was a high school dropout rate of higher than 20%, where the overall dropout rate was something like 9%. No other immigrant group had a rate higher than 20, and the Mexican-American community had a rate of 41%. Right? So this was kind of an alarm, and it was said that the city may have a large Mexican underclass for generations, and many of the Mexicans within this population are indigenous, right? And that turns out to be part of the issue here. So the children of indigenous Mexicans, as we've discovered, are actually being left back at record rates, right? This wasn't noted at all in the article, but this was a major, I think, a major contributor to the problem. They're typically misidentified as Spanish speakers in the school system. Teachers, administrators don't know anything about indigenous languages, Mexican languages. They think that only Spanish is spoken in Mexico. When the kids don't speak in the English class, then they put them in the Spanish class, but then they don't really speak Spanish either, and then they're left back. So it's misconstrued often as a learning disorder, and then they're put in special ed. So this is a major issue for talking about language justice, then the ignorance around indigenous languages and the educational consequences of that ignorance are a very serious issue in New York City. Slightly more abstractly, there's different ideologies that play a role. So there's ideologies about language learning that are different across nationalities, ethnicities, social classes. If you look at the more economically successful immigrant groups, Korean, Chinese, Russian, French, Spanish, Yiddish speakers, they subtractive assimilation was never a big part of their communities in New York. The Chinese community had Chinese school, the Korean community has Korean school, Yiddish was promoted to a smaller extent, Spanish, French, all of these languages had support. And so it never took root, really, this idea that you had to lose your culture in order to succeed in America. But that is the model for people coming from post-colonial societies, where that is a common theme, especially among indigenous populations, that you have to abandon your language and abandon your culture to get ahead. Right? And that ideology is brought to New York. That's the norm. Okay, so that sums up some of those issues. To move to mapping, something maybe happier. This was a map that we helped make for Joshua Jelishapir and Rebecca Stolnitz, a recent Atlas Nonstop Metropolis, a New York City Atlas. It was a book I'm sure a lot of you are familiar with. Many different, very interesting, creative maps of different, all kinds of things. This was the language map. You could look at this as the New York's most linguistically dense area. It's the, around here, Jackson Heights, Elmhurst area. The zip code for Jackson Heights is actually the most linguistically dense zip code in all of the United States, and by extension, I think, the world. But you have it there. So what is this, actually? Does this really represent reality? In some sense, yeah. So you have the larger national languages in orange, right? And we know that they're centered in those areas. But then within those language group, within those national communities, you have many local languages, right? And mapping those is actually impossible, right? So now I've divulged the truth behind this map, is that a lot of this is really fitting words where there's space. because there is no Chavacano or Iwari area or Iloco area. There's a Filipino area, there's an Indonesian area, there's a Greek area, but there aren't really communities, physical communities for regional languages in Jackson Heights. There's national communities. So some of the difficulties in mapping, and hopefully some of you or the project can tackle these problems, I think they're beyond me, is this distinction between physical communities, right? We know where those are. There's an Italian community here, a Greek community there. And these atomized communities, if they're communities at all, they're really collections of individuals. Right? They're not grouping together as much. Another problem is transnational communities. Right? You do have ethnic groups and language groups that span across countries. Right? And how do you map those? How do you map a language that belongs to several countries? I'll give an example a little later. And also, yeah, locating these embedded communities, which is the biggest problem of all. Is there anything to locate in the first place? And if there is, how do we find that? Right? These are languages that nobody puts down on the census form because they think, why would anybody care? People from my own country don't even know this language. Why would the government know this language? So official data on regional languages, non-official languages, is almost null. So what we've been interested in, or I've been interested in particular, is looking at language maintenance and to what extent these languages are changing in New York City, to what extent they're mixing in diaspora settings. Joshua Fishman, who's a famous linguist, noted that in the vast majority of cases, immigrant languages, languages of immigrant communities are lost in two generations. That was the limit he gave. You can't keep a language without some spectacular effort or separation, like the Amish or Yiddish speakers. Without that, it's very rare that you keep a language more than two generations in a diaspora setting. So I'm interested in this question of can smaller languages buck this observation or not? And what happens to these languages that are actually small language families like Tibetan and Mixteco, which I mentioned, where they have a tremendous amount of internal diversity. So Tibet, I spoke a little bit about Mexico. As I said, the other main donor of linguistic diversity to New York is Himalayan languages. And now we're talking about Nepal mostly. So Himalayan languages, mostly, all the languages we're looking at belong to the Tibeto-Burman group, which is distantly related to Chinese, but very, very different from Chinese. And we're looking at this under the auspices of this project, the Voices of the Himalayas project, which is led by Nawam Guru, who's here in the back, if you want to speak to him. And we're looking at a population of around 20,000 people who are living in Queens and Brooklyn. And the goal is to document the languages as they're spoken here, and also the social history of the community. Right? It's a new community that's only arrived within the last 15, 20 years, so in large numbers. Within that community, the Mustangi community is of special interest because relatively they have a very large presence here. There's around 3,000 Mustangis who speak a Tibetic language in two varieties, lower and upper. And in Nepal, there's many monolinguals in more isolated areas, but younger people are shifting to Nepali. I'm particularly interested in these cases of individuals learning their heritage language in New York. So that's a kind of unexpected thing, right? You have a younger person who's already shifted to the major language, the main language. They come to New York, and then surprisingly, in many cases, they shift back to their heritage language. Right? How does that happen, and why does that happen, and does that give some hope for endangered languages in New York City? So this was one interview we did, which is a case like that. As I said later, there were more and more of our people here, so I had a real chance to talk to them in Mustangi, and I got to know the language very well. And this, to my surprise, this turned out to be a more common story than I could have imagined. So just to look at another interesting fact that relates to mapping in this community. So this is Nepal in the middle there, and India on the bottom, and the Tibetan region of China on top, and Bhutan and Bangladesh, as you see. And we're interested in this little square there, which includes the Mustang region. This is the same map, but with elevations, right? So you see that we're well on top of the Tibetan plateau there. So this is the little square I showed here, right? So if we zoom into there, that is the area of Mustang, okay? That little valley, that this area on top is upper Mustang, and the bottom is lower Mustang, and this is all in this Annapurna conservation area. This is a map from Charles Bramble's book on the history of the region. So let me just say, as I mentioned, there's two main dialects in this small area. There's the upper dialect, which is basically the top half, and then there's the lower dialect, which is the bottom half. And then there's also all kinds of other little variations. And within the lower half, there's a language called Seke, around the area that's grayed out there. It says Shoyu. Shoyu, that is the Seke language, which is a separate language. Okay. So interestingly and surprisingly, this map of Mustang actually maps perfectly to New York City. So you have upper Mustang in the Jackson Heights area. and you have lower Mustang around the neighborhood. And I thought this was a joke originally when I first spoke with Nawal. When I first met Nawal, we were going to make a recording. I asked him, where do most of the Mustangis live? And he said, oh, above this certain elevation, Queens, and below this certain elevation, they go to Brooklyn. And I thought it was a joke, but apparently it turned out to be true. Right, so below a certain elevation in the Himalayas, people go to Brooklyn. And then, most surprisingly, the few second speakers, right, I noticed that that gray area was a different language. So the few second speakers in New York live within this lower community, this community from lower Mustang in Brooklyn. So how does this happen? Urban planners, you tell me. How could this happen? Was this planned? Was this done on purpose? Any ideas?
No? Social networks.
Yeah, networks, right. It's the size of the networks, right? So you have this replication, which was quite surprising. It almost looks like it was done on purpose. Of course, nobody could predict that the northern group would actually end up more north in New York City. That part's unpredictable. But you can actually predict that you would find these two areas in Mustang mapping to different areas in New York City, and that a group that is within, a subgroup of one would be a subgroup also in New York City. If you think about it as, you know, maybe through agent-based modeling or just a very small networks, right, people are staying with their relatives, right? So immigration is relying on very small family units that don't really extend far outside the village. So the geographic distributions are really copied from the homeland to New York City, right? Where originally somebody comes, they don't have money, they have to stay with a relative, right? A close relative, generally. So if people are intermarrying within the village and not too far out of the village, then you'll have to rely on somebody that comes from your area, right? So in that way, through these very small family networks, you can get these patterns replicated. So it's actually not a miracle. It's actually quite logical. You find a similar case in this transnational community, the Garifuna community. They're an indigenous, Afro-indigenous group from Central America, and they're along the Central American coast, but they belong to Honduras and Belize and Guatemala and Nicaragua as well. And here in New York, they also follow their national community. So for instance, the ones who come from Belize are in a larger Caribbean community in Brooklyn. The Garifuna who come from Honduras or Guatemala end up in Bronx with a larger Central American Spanish-speaking community, right? So that's another way in which a certain division in the homeland was mapped onto New York City. Right? And again, it has to do with the size of the networks, right? Small family networks can create that pattern. Other patterns as well, which I can't talk about, but other patterns are replicated as well. A recent talk that I saw here a few months ago showed that the disparities in nutrition and malnutrition in indigenous communities in Mexico versus mestizo populations are replicated in New York City. And so totally new city, totally new work environment, but the same differences between indigenous and mestizo populations back home are mapped onto here. Right? And this was actually measured by Dr. Manuel Arcuela, who did studies of malnutrition in New York City. To end, I'm probably over time. Oh, I am over time. What is the future of diversity in New York City? End with this horrible picture. So we have around 600 languages here, we think, we estimate, far upwards of what the census has so far counted. This estimate due to my colleague Juliet Blevins, who's also here, a co-founder of the Endangered Language Alliance. At this point, I think it's pretty obvious, and I had thought this even before the current administration came to power, was that New York City had already reached some peak diversity as far as languages were concerned, for several reasons, but mostly the flow of immigration has changed rapidly over the last 15, 20 years. But now it's totally obvious that I think that we've reached peak diversity linguistically, especially in terms of the languages I've been talking about here, right? These numbers are only going to go down from here. The ongoing crackdown, of course, on immigrants will certainly have a large effect on the endangered languages and their speakers. Indigenous communities from Mexico are being targeted, as we know, and profiled, you know, just over the last month. So any discussion of language justice, and I'll end here, I think should include seeking a way for the recognition of these populations, both Mexican, Himalayan, and others, as bearers of endangered languages and cultures. Right? I'm hoping that if people can change their view of these communities, maybe naively hoping that if people can understand the larger cultural and linguistic context, that that could somehow change the way that they are valued or devalued. And I think I'll end there. I'm sorry, I went over time.
So you mentioned that the rate of new languages being born has slowed down.
Sure.
So you mentioned that the rate of new languages being born has slowed down a lot recently. Does that mean that there's still new languages, I guess, arising? And what's the mechanism for that, I guess, is my question. Is it always, like, derived from another language? And at what point do you decide that it's its own language?
Well, a language can arise through kind of normal means. If you think of, like, biological speciation, you can have a group that just goes off on their own and slowly changes, the language changes slowly, generation after generation. But then you can also have creolization, right? When you have different groups coming together or coming up with a new language. Pidgin languages, which are kind of makeshift languages used to communicate across language groups. So in that sense, you still have an opportunity for new languages. And in fact, within the Himalayan community, we've been looking at something that's called Ramalur, which is the goat and sheep. It's called goat and sheep, which means a kind of a derogatory way of saying a mixed up language. And that's kind of a new, maybe a new dialect that's a kind of mix of different dialects. So I wouldn't say that that's a new language, but you could see potentially a new dialect arising even in New York City through mixing of different languages, you know, especially with these highly multilingual communities.
You also talked about one of the mechanisms for language that being that the language no longer has some kind of social prestige, particularly for children learning it, that it isn't, like, basically cool to speak or that they have to pragmatically speak it. I'm wondering if, like, language restoration projects, like the ones you do, are there, I guess, are there ways that you try to make the language more attractive to learn for children? Like, what kind of strategies do you have?
So, well, first of all, the real work on the front is really in the communities themselves. So we don't have much hope that we can really revitalize the language in New York City. I mean, most of them support it through the things I showed in the beginning. But there is a lot of effort being given to creating new media, electronic media, in indigenous languages. So just the act of creating a YouTube video or the process of texting in the language can, in many ways, increase its prestige. Right? You have to realize that for many of these communities, the unwritten languages or languages that have lost the writing system, there's sometimes this idea that the language has no grammar, right? Or no rules. It's just something we speak. Languages would go like Spanish, would have rules, but these languages were just, you know, it's just the way we speak. So just the act of putting it on paper or, you know, doing these other electronic things with them is a big step towards seeing them as equal with national languages. So definitely. And musical things and performance, things like that. There's been a lot of people looking into hip hop and indigenous languages and how that can make the language cool again for the younger generation.
Queen's Museum, just for the architectural audience over here, because there was a different map. It was a different map up there, an interactive map. Could you talk a little bit, because it more directly focused on the building, restaurants, or you clicked on it, you saw sort of.
Yeah, so that map, that was an artistic rendition. We didn't make that map. We gave the data for that map, and then the artist together with a data person created that map, and there was some algorithm. The colors, I believe, had to do with language family, and the size was in New York. Roughly into New York City. So they used data that we had collected, but then they turned it into that. The details of that cardiogram didn't escape me. We kind of gave it to them as a few numbers and languages, and then they did that with it. But I don't know. Looking at it, I don't think that anybody would have, without reading the background, nobody would guess that it's a map.
I think it was too generalized.
No, I think it was an artistic statement. So as with the text and everything, people got the idea.
Right.
But as a map, it was quite abstract.
I'm not a linguist, but I've read a little bit, and I understand that the word dialect has become somewhat complicated. And I noticed that you use it occasionally, and I'm just wondering, what's the status of the concept of dialect, you know, within the context of language justice?
So for linguists, the dialect is something that has some level of mutual intelligibility with another related variety. So, for instance, standard British English and standard American English, we would say, are two dialects of the same language because we can understand. We can understand each other easily. So the linguistic definition is completely about mutual intelligibility. Right? Can two people understand each other and to what extent? If they can't understand each other at all, then it's considered two different languages. If they can understand each other somewhat, or if they can understand each other but they speak differently, they're considered dialects.
What about that Scots one?
Yeah, so that's a case of, that's not a linguistic definition. That's the more popular definition, because all varieties of English are called dialects. But as we know, what was that movie? The famous movie from North England with the strippers. Male strippers. Anyway, English, but they had to have subtitles. Nobody knows what I'm talking about. You know what I'm talking about.
The one with the diamond.
That was the other stripper one. Full Monty. They had to have subtitles. So that for a linguist, that would be a totally different. But then a dialect takes on a new meaning in Latin America, where dialect comes to mean any non-official language or non-written language or anything but Spanish or any indigenous language is called a dialect. And that actually becomes a popular term now. So even indigenous communities refer to their languages as dialects. Right? But that's not a linguistic definition. That's kind of a historical colonial definition, where a language was something with a grammar and a history, and this spoken stuff, those were just dialects. Yeah.
Okay. I'm wondering what linguists in general, but specifically the Endangered Language Alliance, views the role not only in New York City, but like back in these indigenous communities and their native places, where there tends to be a lot of pushback on national governments because of the idea of self-determination and of the indigenous peoples and the separation of, like, this national governments with control of them because they have their own identity. How the Native Language Alliance would try to use their data, the documentation that they collect, to aid preservation and efforts back home.
Yeah. So now that almost everybody is on the internet to some extent. There's a lot that we can do, whereas, you know, 20 years ago it would have been unthinkable, but now we can produce media here with a few individuals and hope that it has an effect back home. And in some cases it seems to. So a recent example was a collaborator of ours who speaks Wahi, which is a Iranic language from Tajikistan and the area around there. So we made a video of her, just a simple video of her reading a folktale or improvising a folktale. With the translation and the transcription and everything. And then this last summer, she went back home, and people would stop her and start reciting the folktale to her. The first line of the story. Somehow that video became really popular, and everybody knew about it in her community. So that was, I mean, surprising to me. I wouldn't have thought that it would have been that much of a success. But in those cases, yeah, you can have at least that kind of nominal brain gain. There's this term brain drain and brain gain, right, where you have this idea that all of the intellectual resources of the country out-migrates and screws over the country of origin. But then there's other ideas that there's kind of reverse brain gain, which is that things that are learned here, things that you're able to do in America or other centers of migration, can feed back home. So to what extent that drain and gain plays out over the next few decades is a question, but it will probably play out over the internet, things like YouTube.
Thank you so much, Dan. That was a wonderful lecture. I wonder, I'm often surprised when I see estimates of languages. For instance, in New York City, some would say there are 200 languages in New York City. Michelle Laura and I had a brief discussion as to exactly how many. And the discrepancy, I wonder if the discrepancy has to do with exactly how, whether people take a linguistic criteria or a political criteria as to what a language is. How did you come up, for example, with that estimate, roughly 600 languages? I'm curious, do you work with UNESCO? Because they seem to have some criteria. They, for example, this the number of languages in the People's Republic of China is 144. But then other linguists will come up with different figures, many more than 144. And then I checked some Chinese sources, linguistic journals, they say 78. So I wonder how, if we stick to a linguistic criteria, is it possible to come at a number that on which people would have some consensus, at least among the linguistic community.
Yeah, it's hard. So there's many factors, especially when we talk about the census data. But there are linguistic factors. So historically, there's an idea, for instance, that say Tibetan is one language, or Mixteco is one language, where clearly it's not. It's much more than one language. It's like a small language family, right? So in Tibetan, we've seen this up close with this Voices of the Himalayas project just last week. Mustang was interviewing somebody from the Amdo region. And they were interviewing, he was asking questions and they were answering, and it seemed like they were communicating beautifully. And then afterwards, Nawang said, you know how much I understood of that? 2%. So this is supposed to be the same language, but actually they're two totally different languages for historical reasons, because they all came from classical Tibetan, they're considered one language. Mixteco is the same thing. So that's one cause, right? So according to these macro groupings, for instance, in Mexico, Mexico was supposed to only have something like 150 languages or something like that. When linguists really looked at it and tried to determine, on the basis of mutual intelligibility, they came up with something like 258, right? So 100 more languages. So that's a real issue, and it's difficult to say when the difference between a dialect and a language, right? But linguists have worked pretty hard on that, and I think for some reason, some regions, it's pretty reliable. The other problem is when we're looking at the number of languages in New York City is that nobody fills in their language if it's not already an option, right? So if somebody's from Indonesia, they'll check Indonesian, they're not going to write down their local language, right? Because I mentioned earlier, they think, why would anybody care? It's not even a language I speak much in New York City. It's just totally irrelevant and nobody would know about it. So that's another problem. How we came up with the number, I should pass the microphone to my colleague Juliet Blevins, who helped come up with that number. It was an extrapolation. You want to talk about it?
Sure.
Yeah.
Well, the original number was 800, so I guess we've become a little bit more conservative over time. But
Yeah, what we did was we looked at the largest immigrant groups. One group that Daniel didn't talk about tonight was populations from India and surrounding areas. India as a country is estimated to have over 100 indigenous languages, and very large, some of them have very large populations. So we were actually very conservative, thinking that, for instance, if there are 150 languages in Mexico, maybe half of them would be spoken in New York. It turns out there's more, right? I think we're finding that the figure was low. But maybe Daniel could comment more about India and surrounding areas. What you're saying about China as well figured into the calculations, because we know as more and more people do research on local languages of China that there's so much more mutual non-intelligibility. However, because of the writing system, people assume it's all one language. So, Daniel, do you want to talk about India?
I'm just curious about how you've gone about locating some of these speakers, and if you could speak a bit to the ethics that doing so entails, mapping or locating marginalized groups or individuals.
Yeah, so we definitely never intend to, we don't map individuals, right? Because any of these languages are represented, in some cases, really by only, seemingly only one person in New York. That's another mapping issue I didn't mention. Right? What do you do with a single person? You map them? Does that mean anything? So, no, you don't map it. How we find people through a combination of contacting community centers, but actually, most of our contacts, I would say, our network was kind of formed in 2010 when this article in the New York Times came out. It was about endangered languages in New York City, and it mentioned us. And all of a sudden, we got a lot of emails from all kinds of communities we never heard of before. And really, that had a snowball effect. And from there, we got many, many contacts. And to some extent, we've walked the streets with clipboards. But more commonly, through community centers, through contacts we already have. Yeah. I mean, ideally, we like to work with individuals from a community who are interested in exploring their own community. Right? So, but there are a lot of difficult ethical questions now, especially, even more so than.
So, for instance, what do you do with the data? Everything that you recorded? Like, who has the rights to that, and what happens in
The rights to the data, whenever we record, we get permission to make the data public, so the goal is to make it public. Otherwise, we could just put it locked up in some archive somewhere, but then it would kind of defeat the purpose. So we would not, we don't record unless we have permission to make things public.
Oh, no,
I
don't mean to imply
it. It can be. I mean, if we're working with undocumented people and we make videos of them, and even just last year, I would think, that's a negligible risk, but now, who knows?
You spoke about some sort of like synergy and parallels between linguistic and biological diversity, and as someone who's sort of speaking about endangered languages, people also speak about endangered animal species as well, and they obviously sometimes run into challenges for people who would ask, well, why are we talking about this? And like language, for people who like languages, it's very obvious why we like linguistic diversity and that sort of thing. Could you talk about sort of some of the challenges that you had at outreach to the general population about why your work is really important?
Yeah, I have to say I haven't toured the country and tried to convince people on the street that it's important, because mostly we end up working with people who already feel it's important, who either speak these languages or are part of a certain community. So there's been less of a, often I speak to very sympathetic audiences. I would actually like to speak to a very unsympathetic audience once. I don't know how they can do that. So, yeah, I don't know, I mean, there is maybe not so much pushback because there's less knowledge about language endangerment than there is about species endangerment, and of course you have corporations and whatnot pushing back against the regulations that protect species and nature. So, yeah, convincing people, I don't know, there's still the first task is to really raise awareness before we can really start arguing for it. But I think it's the speakers make the case the clearest that this is their right, you know, it's their identity, it's their right. It's something that was taken away from them in most cases. So, you know, I find it hard to argue with, but that's obviously what I feel. That's why I need to answer with about interest.
I thought a point that was really interesting was that there was this population of students speaking indigenous Mexican languages who are getting misidentified as Spanish speakers in the classroom, and the severe impact that has on, you know, their matriculation. And I was just wondering if you had any ideas or thoughts or solutions about what can be done on the education, from an educational systemic like perspective, to preserve their indigenous languages while also supporting these kind of students in the classroom.
Yeah, I mean, the story is actually quite, it's more complicated than I may have been able to indicate. But first of all, what's obvious, there has to be some kind of campaign to educate administrators, principals, and teachers, you know, that these languages exist, and just so they know more about these countries and their populations, because in some neighborhoods in New York, it's really a significant population in the school system. So that's something that, that has to be done, and definitely I'd like to play a bigger role in that. But also there's, the issue is actually quite complicated. When you look at the younger children, it turns out that a lot of them actually are not fluent speakers. Most of them are not fluent speakers of the indigenous language. And some of them, in fact, are kind of in-between languages, between Spanish, English, and their indigenous language, which has to do with this kind of, it's a post-colonial or colonial mindset that people bring here, that you kind of, you shouldn't speak your mother tongue at home if it's an indigenous language. So it's a dual problem. On one part, it's educating the educators, but then also really investigating what's going on with that population of children. What language are they really most comfortable in? Because it's actually not really the case that they're most comfortable in the indigenous language. So the families also need to be told that it's okay to speak their language at home. I had a video clip which I didn't have time to show, but that's a big issue within those communities, you know, where you have family members fighting with each other when one of them talks to their kid, for instance, in their language. So, you know, that's a big
job.
Thanks so much for the amazing talk. My question is about the also definitions and what you I think called the spectrum of death. And I'm really curious about whether or not there is that moment when death is announced for a language, and if that is a matter of the language kind of stopping to evolve, but also what does that mean for preservation programs or maintenance programs, as you call them, and what are the risks? I mean, if I can relate it to preservation also in architecture, what are the risks of preservation kind of the not allowing for a language to continue to evolve or?
Yeah, there's several questions there, right? So the language changing, which has its own issues, and the language just giving way to another language completely. And the issue of when is a language extinct is very difficult, and a kind of political one as well, because this term, extinct language or dead language, was just a commonly accepted term for a long time. And then there was pushback on the part of indigenous communities that said, what right do you have to say that we're extinct and that we speak a dead language, that our language is dead and gone, right? So even the terminology is difficult. You know, the term that came to replace that was then sleeping language, and the idea was that the language could be revived, because in some cases it was revived. It died and then came back, right? Which is something that humans have a hard time doing, but if you have grammar and recordings and texts, then you can actually bring the language back. Right? It happened with Hebrew, of course, and it happened in two MacArthur Awards were given to Native Americans recently, who did the same thing with their languages through the help of a linguist and through texts and a lexicon. They actually brought their language back within their small family network, but they brought it back. So if that's the case, then maybe extinct is really a bad term. So there's the politics of that, and then the issue of language change is another question, right? You have indigenous languages, other languages changing all the time, in some cases very rapidly. In some cases, people try to bring back a language, but it's already influenced by English or Spanish, and the older generation disapproves, and the younger generation says this is the best we can do. And so that becomes a very contentious issue with almost all of the language revitalization programs.
I am an undergrad here at Columbia College. I'm studying linguistics and human rights, and I really am looking forward to doing work in minority and indigenous language preservation one day. And I, as an undergrad, sometimes feel as a student this overwhelming sense of dread when I think about all these languages dying out. And knowing that I can't do anything about it right now. And I'm just wondering how you deal with that in the field, the being there, seeing these languages, and trying to preserve them. Like, what is your mindset when you go into this? And
like I said, here in New York City, we're not really in the trenches, or we're not in the front lines of this fight, which is really, but it's, you know, it's an easy thing to think that. But the people who are really on the front lines and in the trenches of this work are making kindergartens and daycare centers, immersion programs, right? And those are the people who are really doing the most effective things to keep a language alive. So in a way, working here, mostly in New York City, you're removed from the more brutal aspects of it in a way. But there will always be a lot that can be done, right? I mean, the languages that are safe now will be endangered. I mean, if we're going to lose up to 90% of the languages of the world, then there's an endless amount of work to be done. Don't
next week, the speaker is coming, Anna Doremart from South Africa, and her talk is going to be about really the way that language has been preserved through text, messaging, through cell phone texts, because of, and by that, gets preserved through recording it in some
so
way.
So, language, identity, text messaging, language revitalization,
optimistic.
It's going to be awesome.
Yeah.
Temper that.
We'll have one more question and then
you should temper that.
Related to that, actually. I did once that they did it. I think BBC did a story on this, and I was trying to give the positive side of, you know, recording these languages, trying to promote them, revitalize them in New York City. And I thought I was giving a very positive picture. And the title of the article ended up being something like New York City, biggest language graveyard. What happened? The author said it was the editor, but I mean, the positive side, like I mentioned, there are these cases where people have managed to actually bring back languages that were no longer spoken. So. With, in the worst case, documentation can still give hope.
On the writer's side, I'd like to coin that question. How can we in this room support the work that your organization specifically does, and it's then also as like a creative project?
Oh, so nice. Juliet, you want to talk about?
Sorry.
Supporting the work that we do. Resources, of course, so resources are very short. We're actually a very small organization. I don't think that came off as a big organization, but we're a small organization with few resources, so anything that helps in terms of resources is a big help. We do have volunteers over the summer especially. It's tricky, you know, putting all those volunteers to good work, but volunteering helps. And yeah, you can go to our website and see other ways, but yeah.
Anyone who has skills in prep, I mean, there are hours and hours of recordings that have been actually
genetically,
so. Yeah. In using software for genetic analysis.
Right.
Yes.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.